good to see everybody here this morning. And if you're watching with us at home, thank you for joining us at home. Hopefully you were able to navigate to our video stream here and watch us. It is a great day, this Pentecost Sunday, as we are reminded of the original day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came to the believers. What a great thing. And if you can see here, we have some red. And we were talking, well, what does the red represent? We were talking about that this week. It's the tongues of fire that the Holy Spirit laid on people. That fire is represented by red for the day of Pentecost. We have the red here. And we're so thankful you could join us today. Just want to let everybody know that starting this Wednesday, for our Wednesday night service, we're going to do something a little bit different. Over the next 3 Wednesdays, we're going to be going through the Nazarene Articles of Faith. And this will also function as a membership class for those who are seeking membership in our church. I know some of you have had that conversation with me. And so if you do want to become an official member here, if that's not something you've done yet already, we will be starting that class over these next 3 Wednesdays. And so that'll be 6:30 to 7:30 p.m. And if you're not comfortable being here in person, you can still watch those on the live stream. And that will that will be just fine as well. So I wanted to make you aware of that. I'm glad that you're here today. I'm thankful that you're here today. Let's worship our Lord and Savior this morning.
Well, would you stand with us and sing, "Blessed be the name of the Lord." Let's stand together and sing.
Thank you.
may be seated. Fortress. And in verse 10 he says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our strength.
Fitting song for today, because we are reminded that the Holy Spirit is with us and will never leave our side. I'm going to read very briefly out of Acts chapter 2. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. Here is a prayer I found for today. It says this: Blessed God, who danced in our hearts filling us with the knowledge of your presence. Let your proclamation sing forth from us, as it sang from the lips of Hannah and Elizabeth, announcing the coming of your promise and the fulfillment of your desire. God, we bow before you today, being reminded of the great gift you've given us, the Holy Spirit. In fact, this whole sermon series, we've been talking about the different fruits of the Spirit, and that's only because we have your Spirit living in us. We have you living in us right by our side, always here. We thank you for that, God. Father, we lift up all those in our church this morning who are hurting, who are sick, who need your healing touch, God. We've had many prayer requests this week, Father. Many people hurting, many people broken, many people not knowing what to do. But we know one thing, God, that you are with us and you'll never leave our side. So God, as we walk through these storms, may we feel your presence among us. As we go through these pressing issues of life, may we be reminded that you will never leave our side. We give you thanks. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God is here.
You did not yet get a communion cup. We have some available right up here. If somebody would want to pass those out, just raise your hand if you still need a communion cup. Did everybody get one? We have them on the table out front, but if you do need one. And for all those joining us online, this is a time where if you have some bread or some juice available, please get it, and we will celebrate this amazing thing that sometimes we take for granted, God's forgiveness. But even though we mess up, even though we make mistakes, even though we do some stuff that we regret, we have God's forgiveness. Isn't that great?
Amen.
Amen. I'm going to read again out of Luke chapter 22, and we'll take the elements together. And Jesus took the bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Amen. At this time, the children are dismissed. If you'd like, go out this door here, and we have some fun for them, and also a children's lesson for them this morning. So at this time, all the kiddos are dismissed, and they're actually just going to go right out the door. Yeah, you can even go around the front too if you want. Amen. Let's worship.
Thank you.
Decided to preach from over here today because it works better with our video, with the cross here and everything. So glad to see everybody this morning. So thankful that you're here on this wonderful day. We can worship our Lord and Savior. And if you haven't been with us in a while, we've been going through the fruits of the Spirit, talking about those different virtues or attributes that God works within us in our lives. As we grow in our Christian journey, as we become more and more sanctified, those things that God does within us. We talked about love, we talked about joy, we talked about peace, and today we're going to talk about patience. You know, and this is a hard one for some of us, this idea of patience, but the Bible's clear. As the Holy Spirit works within us, we will become more patient people, believe it or not, and maybe it's hard for you to realize that from your own life, or maybe you realize that very well. Maybe you look to your past and think, wow, look at who I was back then. Maybe you like that. Look at who I was back then. I was so impatient, so anxious, so aggressive, you know, all the time. God works that attribute within our lives. And just to kind of start off the conversation, we're going to look at Ecclesiastes chapter 7. And that's a good book, isn't it? Ecclesiastes. You ever read that one? That's an interesting book. But we're just going to read verses 8 and 9. And here's what Ecclesiastes says about patience. It says, finishing is better than starting. Patience is better than pride. Control your temper, for anger labels you a fool. Can you relate with that passage? You ever been there? You ever got so impatient at something, and you look back, and you're just like, wow, I probably looked like a fool in that situation. And maybe it wasn't even a public thing. Maybe it was just impatience within yourself. And you look back and you say, God, you know, why was I being such a fool in that scenario? And so some good wisdom there from the book of Ecclesiastes. Patience is better than pride. Control your temper, for anger labels you a fool. And so we know that as the Holy Spirit works in our lives, He will produce within us the fruit of patience, and it is a good thing. And so the word for patience in the Bible is a very unique word. In Greek literature, it was sometimes used to describe how a master would show forgiveness and mercy towards a servant when they messed up. And so we know from the get-go here that a big part of the definition of patience is this idea of having mercy, having forgiveness, having kindness. That's part of the definition of what it means to be a patient person. This word throughout the Old Testament also referred to this idea of cancellation of debt. We know that in the Old Testament, God regularly instructed His people to show grace and mercy and kindness towards others one specific way, the cancellation of debt. Wouldn't that be a cool thing? The cancellation of debt. Patience. That was one of the ways it was used. When the Bible talks about God withholding righteous judgment on mankind, the same word is used to describe God's patient character. And so, as we start to talk about patience here this morning, a good place for us to look is to God. And we see patience exhibited by God throughout Scripture. We don't deserve the goodness of God, but since God is a patient God, He grants us grace and forgiveness anyway. Aren't we thankful for that this morning? However, we are not God, and we don't really have any servants today like they did back then. And so what does the biblical word patience mean for us today? What does this word mean for us today? And we're going to look at Romans chapter 2, verse 4. I think we have this one. It says this: "Don't you see how wonderfully kind, tolerant, and patient God is with you? Does this mean nothing to you? Can't you see that His kindness is intended to turn you from your sin?" And so the original translation, it's interesting. It can actually be translated as something like, you know, why do you look down upon God, or why do you treat God with contempt? Why do you underestimate God's goodness, God's kindness, God's patience? And we do that sometimes, don't we? We underestimate it. We see God exhibit patience with His people throughout Scripture. And so as we talk about patience this morning, we can look to God as the ultimate definition of patience, because whether we like to admit it or not, if we're honest, we can be some hard people to be around sometimes. You look at God and you look at the way in which you stubbornly act or behave sometimes. And we're thankful for a patient God this morning, aren't we? You know, God has to deal with us every day. We're thankful for a patient God. Because sometimes we act very foolish. Sometimes we just keep being stubborn over and over again. And so as we talk about what it means to have patience, we can look to God and say, God, thank you for showing me what it looks like to have patience by dealing with me. And so that's kind of where we're at this morning for many of us. Okay, we're going to look at 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 10. Here's what it says. Again, talking about God's patience. "But you must not forget this one thing, dear friends. A day is like 1,000 years to the Lord, and 1,000 years is like a day. The Lord isn't really being slow about His promise, as some people think. No, He's being patient for your sake. He does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everyone to repent. But the day of the Lord will come as unexpectedly as a thief. Then the heavens will pass away with a terrible noise, and the very elements themselves will disappear in fire, and the earth and everything on it will be found to deserve judgment." And so we find here in the context of this verse, you know, God's people very, very frustrated that they had to experience hardship and persecution and tribulation. And they're saying, God, why don't you do something about this? Why don't you do something about this? Look at the way that I've been having to live. Peter here, what is he saying? He's saying God is a patient God, and He wants to allow time for as many people as possible to repent, to change, to turn around. And we all deal with difficult people. And we say, God, why do I have to deal with all these difficult people? Let's exhibit patience and be a good example for the Lord. So how does God show patience towards us? I think this biblical word for patience goes much deeper than we realize. When people wrong us, when people make us upset, we're sometimes quick to retaliate. Anybody like that? We're sometimes quick to retaliate. And even if we don't say anything, you know, with our words or do anything with our actions, sometimes from the inside, we exhibit impatience. We have these feelings of impatience. So what does this mean? You know, if you're out and about, at a store, or a restaurant, wherever, and one of the employees, or maybe this other customer, cuts in front of you, or maybe the employees are working a little too slow for your taste, or something like that. Sometimes we feel a little bit of impatience. We say, I'm not being treated fairly, you know, I'm having to wait in line too long, or something like that. And those are valid thoughts. Those are valid thoughts. But it's also those feelings of impatience that are within us. And so as we talk about the biblical word for patience, it's not necessarily something that just involves us restraining our actions. It's something that is in the inside of us. Maybe we're like this big bubble about to burst, full of impatience, but we don't actually do or say anything. Now that's a good thing, we're holding it back, you know. But we're still not being patient. Because on the inside of us, we're about to burst. The work that God wants to do in our lives is a work on the inside of us, not just the outside. Yes, it's good that you didn't blow up at the store employee, or you didn't chew out this person or that person because of the way they treated you or whatever. But God wants us to do more than that. He wants us to be able to show kindness, show mercy, be quick to forgive, see other people's perspectives, empathize with other people. Realizing and remembering that ultimately it's our job to be witnesses of Christ, and that's the most important thing. And so just because we're holding back our impatience, I mean, that's good, but that's not the end of the story. God wants to work so deep within us that we come to a point where people can wrong us, people can inconvenience us, and we show grace. We show mercy. We show kindness. We show forgiveness. So biblical patience starts on the inside, and it springs up onto the outside. And it's like that with all the fruits of the Spirit, really. You know, you can, you talk about, you know, being loving or being joyful. You can fake it, right? You can fake having joy. You can fake being loving. But that's not really the work that God wants to do within us. He wants to do it on the inside. He wants us to be patient people from the inside, and that flows unto others. So how do you show patience to others? What does this struggle look like in your life? It's a good question for us to ask this morning. It's a good way we can examine our lives this morning. God, how do you want me to be a more patient person this week? The word patience can be translated as endurance or perseverance that the Holy Spirit puts inside of us that ultimately produces kindness and mercy. Again, it's this endurance, it's this perseverance that God is working within us that ultimately produces kindness and mercy and grace. That'd be a good definition of patience, biblical patience. We're going to look at the Psalms this morning. And we see David here seek to address this question in Psalm chapter 37. He tries to answer this question, why do the wicked seem to always prosper? Why does it feel like sometimes all the bad things happen to us and there's people that aren't following God and their lives are way better? Anyway, the whole chapter of Psalm 37 is devoted to this, but we're just going to read verses 7 through 9. Here's what it says. Be still in the presence of the Lord and wait patiently for Him to act. Don't worry about evil people who prosper or fret about their wicked schemes. Stop being angry. Turn from your rage. Do not lose your temper. It only leads to harm. For the wicked will be destroyed, but those who trust in the Lord will possess the land. And this is a good reminder for us, and we're reminded even today that biblical authors and people have dealt with patience. God's people have dealt with this issue of patience from the beginning. asking the question, why do I have to suffer when this person who's not following God has it so good? Well, the Lord is saying here, the Psalms is saying here, be patient. I mean, we know the great inheritance that we have. We know the great inheritance that we have through Jesus. Be patient as you live this life. Be patient as you journey through this earth. Be patient at your job. Be patient with who God has put around you. Because ultimately, God has given us a great and eternal inheritance. But we just got to be patient in the meantime and show patience. And it's hard, you know. It's hard. But ultimately, God is victorious. And He works within us this fruit of the Spirit, patience, as we walk on our Christian journey. Patience in action. Sometimes showing kindness and mercy in a situation does not have an immediate benefit. Sometimes showing kindness and mercy in a situation does not have an immediate benefit, but living that lifestyle will pay off. And we're going to read Galatians chapter 6. I think we have this one up here. Galatians chapter 6, verses 8 through 10. Talking about a harvest and waiting patiently for a harvest. Maybe some of you have been there. Here's what it says. Those who live only to satisfy their own sinful nature will harvest decay and death from that sinful nature. But those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting life from the Spirit. So let's not get tired of doing what is good. In other words, let's exhibit patience. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. And so just kind of conquering this idea, discussing this idea, you know, we're patient people, we show patience, but sometimes you run out of patience, don't we? You ever been there? You show patience for somebody, you show patience in a certain situation. But sometimes that patience runs dry, and we have to say, God, give me some more patience. It's Monday through Thursday at work, I've been patient, but it's Friday, and I can't take it anymore. Have you ever been there? And the whole idea here is that sometimes exhibiting patience in a situation does not necessarily have an immediate benefit or an immediate payoff, but continually exhibiting patience and being self-disciplined and creating this as a spiritual discipline in our lives will ultimately make us more fruitful people and transform us into the way God wants us to be. And so the author here uses the example of a harvest. He starts off here talking about sinful nature in verse 8, talking about sinful nature. And when we're so focused on ourselves, and specifically so focused on fulfilling our own sinful desires, fulfilling our own sinful nature, doing those things we know we shouldn't do, but not really caring about God's law or God's path. Maybe we've been there before. Maybe it's fun at first. Maybe it's pleasurable for a season, but ultimately, it only leads to decay and destruction. That's kind of what Galatians 6 is pointing at here. But when we're walking with the Holy Spirit, specifically through patience here, when we're walking with the Holy Spirit, this describes not only a life that endures forever, but also the highest quality of life that a person can experience. And so as we talk about patience this morning, we recognize that as we exhibit patience, it boosts the quality of our life. It gives us a better life, and ultimately, it's part of being on this path towards eternal life. It gives us the best possible life we could experience as we're filled with the fruits of the Spirit. So not just patience, but all the fruits of the Spirit. You know, if you want to live the best life, focus on the fruits of the Spirit. Say, God, work these fruits within me. And even though it's tough sometimes, just like the harvest, waiting for the harvest, the example here, it pays off. Because as we become more and more and more patient people, and God does that work within us, ultimately it's going to be a good thing for us, and a good thing for others. And that's the path that God has called us on. We'll read one more passage here in James chapter 5. This is another example, similar example of this idea of patience, you know, being compared with farmers waiting for a harvest. And we actually talked about this a few months ago when we went through the book of James. But here's what it says in verses 7 and 8 in James chapter 5. Dear brothers and sisters, be patient as you wait for the Lord's return. Consider the farmers who patiently wait for the rains in the fall and in the spring. They eagerly look for the valuable harvest to ripen. You too must be patient. Take courage, for the coming of the Lord is near. And if you remember back then, what was the church dealing with? I mean, not only were they dealing with just the general sense of persecution and tribulation that the early church dealt with, but specifically there was these rich people, and we don't know all the details, but the Bible says in James chapter 5, there was lots of rich people which were trying to oppress the church. And there was lawsuits and there was things like that happening. And we don't have exactly all of the details, but James kind of offers us this sense of encouragement. He said, you know, things aren't so great right now, per se, but exhibit patience. Because ultimately, when all this is over, God has given us this great inheritance. And ultimately, God is king, God is judge. And one day, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. But while you're here, you know, experiencing this persecution, this tribulation, be patient. Exhibit patience. Have that perseverance within you that ultimately produces kindness and mercy and forgiveness. Because we know how the story ends, you know. We know the great gift of salvation and forgiveness that God has given us. But for right now, as we live this life, as we journey on this Christian walk, we must exhibit patience. And that's the fruit of the Spirit that God wants to work within us. And so as we wrap things up today, just ask yourself the question. Ask God the question, Lord, how do you want me to exhibit patience in my life? Is there a specific area? Is there a specific person? Is there a specific context where I need to work on this area of patience, where I need to exhibit more patience? Or I need to exhibit more perseverance, more endurance, showing kindness, showing forgiveness, showing mercy, showing God's grace to others. Is there some person in my life today, some situation, something where I can do a better job at having patience? And so that's the big question we need to ask ourselves today as we talk about this fruit of the Spirit, patience. And hopefully God will lead each of us into a new revelation, into a new understanding, a new reality of what having patience means for our lives in our day-to-day. Let's make that our prayer for this week. Let's pray together. Father, we are so thankful. We are so grateful this morning, God, that we have your Spirit living within us. We have your Spirit living within us, God, and we don't have to do this on our own. It may seem overwhelming. These people, these situations we're dealing with, they seem overwhelming, God, but we have your Spirit living in us. And you show us what it means to have patience. God, we give you thanks. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you would work within each of us this morning. Show us what it means to have patience. Show us how you want to do that work in our lives this week. Jesus' name. Amen. So I'm going to read our benediction and then we'll be dismissed. And as you exit, Pastor Mike will have our offering basket. And if you do have a financial gift this morning, feel free to just place it in that basket as you leave. And we wanted to also thank everyone joining us from home for your continued gifts and remind you that you can give via our website. You can mail your gift physically or drop it off physically in our mailbox. We have a drop-off slot. And we are thankful this month we've raised just over $300 for Love Works Ministry. And so we want to thank everyone for their continued gifts to that great ministry and your continued prayers as Susie Kimball recovers. She is now in rehab, and we did send out the address for cards and that sort of thing, even though they're not taking any visitors at this time. And if you do need that address, you did not receive it, come talk to me. We will get that for you. But we just want to thank the church for continuing to be a part of the church and giving and serving in every area. And so, as you exit this morning, Pastor Mike will be out there, and I'm going to close this morning with our benediction, and then you'll be dismissed. Go now and celebrate wherever God's name is honored. When suffering comes, pray in faith. In times of joy, sing songs of praise. Persevere in prayer and action to bring the fallen back to the truth. And may God save you from all that would harm you. May Christ Jesus heal you and raise you up. And may the Holy Spirit anoint you and give you peace with one another. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.